Today I'm going to be reviewing the LinkStation-in-1. This compact SSD-only NAS has the ability to put 6 SSDs inside of it, has a 2.5 gigabit network jack, a pretty competent iGPU for transcoding media, as well as an included unRAID license to run a pretty nice OS on this unit already. And in this video, I'm going to dive into the hardware, run some benchmarks, do thermal testing, take a look at the power consumption, go over my thoughts of this unit and the hardware that they picked and kind of how that works together to make this unit as a whole, and just go over my thoughts of kind of these compact SSD NAS units as kind of a market and who should consider a unit like this. As a disclaimer, LinkStation provided me with this NAS for the purpose of making this review, and also provided links that I put in the video description if you want to take a look at this unit's product page. I also want to do a quick disclaimer that this is my second in-one system that I had. The first one had a dead network card and they replaced it for me so I could have a fully functional system. With that out of the way, let's get into the review of this unit. The form factor of this unit is a pretty small compact NAS unit. It's not the smallest one on the market, but seeing the hardware that they put inside of it, I don't think they could have put it much smaller without taking out features. In addition to the unit itself, it comes with a relatively small 12-volt, 5-amp barrel jack power adapter to run the unit on. Taking a look at the features on this physical unit, starting off with the front, there is a power LED that glows when turned on, as well as indicators for the drives on the system, as well as the included network card. There is also a RGB strip that reflects off the bottom metal of the chassis that glows when running. It seems to do kind of a RGB bluish breathing when running all the time with not great ways to control it from what I can see in the manual. I am typically not the biggest fan of RGB on units like this, but as far as RGB goes, it kind of blends into the background, so I'm not going to complain about it too much. The front little metal bezel can be folded down, and I can see the two 2.5-inch hard drive or SSD drive sleds, which have a SATA 6 gigabit connection and can fit drives up to 9 millimeters tall, which means basically all consumer-grade SATA SSDs. The hard drive sleds are fairly easy to use and come with screws and screwdrivers to install your drives. And in the middle of those is a USB Type-C port. It's branded as doing 10 gigabit, but using multiple devices across multiple OSs, I only got 5 gigabit out of it. I don't know if it's something weird with my unit or it's actually a 5 gigabit port that was branded incorrect. On the sides and top of the unit, there's no vents or no other features to speak of. And moving over to the back of the unit, there's all the rest of the I/O on the system. Starting from left to right, there's an audio jack output, a little reset button, HDMI output, two USB Type-A 5 gigabit ports, a 2.5 gigabit network controller powered by a Realtek RTL125 network card, as well as a DC input from the power brick. And then on the very bottom under the USB ports is a small exhaust vent for the included fan. Moving over to the bottom of the system is a nice toolless way to access all the built-in M.2 drive bays. And I'll give it credit, this is my favorite toolless M.2 drive solution I've seen on any NAS. I actually just installed a little drive right now, and it's about as painless and quick as I could get for any toolless system. The unfortunate part is due to the included CPU and N5105 on this system, there's limited PCIe lanes and all of these drive bays only run at PCIe Gen 3x1, which is a bit under 1 gigabit for all of these drives. There's also a little USB 2.0 port hidden in here for the included 4 gigabyte USB that the unRAID installation included uses as its boot drive. Now that I've gone over the outside hardware, let's take a look inside of this unit. Taking this unit apart involves taking out the two back screws, as well as doing a little bit of prying, and the whole top of the system pops off. One thing that's interesting immediately that I saw is the top of the unit actually has metal attached to it and some thermal paste. So it looks like they're using the top of this panel as kind of a heat sink to keep the CPU running a bit cooler. Then I can see the board included with the CPU, processor, and everything on it in a T-shape to get those spots for those 2.5-inch drive bays, as well as some board-to-board interconnects for the bottom M.2 drive solution. It's a pretty well-packed overall system and quite densely built. Once I took out the main board on this system, I can see the CPU itself, which plugs into a small heatsink that has a tiny little fan on it. And under this heatsink is the Intel N5105 processor. The CPU has its included graphics, which is enabled on the system, as well as 4E or Atom cores on the CPU to do all of the processing. This system's clock speeds go anywhere between about 2 GHz to 2.9 depending on the workload. This system seemed to sit roughly in like the 2.5, 2.6 GHz range with a moderately intensive all-core load running on it and peaking at that 2.9 GHz load when running a single-threaded task that wasn't super intensive on the CPU. The default PL1 or long-term power limit was 10 watts on this unit and 12 watts for its short-term power limit, but both of those could be easily adjusted in the BIOS to raise them later on. This is a bit older low-power embedded CPU with 4 E-cores or Atom-based cores on the system as well as its iGPU with transcoding capabilities. CPU performance-wise, this system compared to an N100 is a bit slower. Here's some different benchmarks I ran, with this system being 100 in every test and the N100 scores varying compared to it. As you can see here, the N100 is a decent step up CPU performance-wise. In all of the NAS use cases and just navigating through UnRAID, this system ran fine, but it's hard to complain about additional performance, especially when an N100 appears to be in about the same price and power consumption portfolio as this CPU does here, but there's likely factors I'm missing in just this quick comparison. The transcoding capabilities of the CPU is fairly impressive. It is running a bit older of an Intel QuickSync module built into it, so you aren't doing things like AV1 decoding on this system, but if you're working with H.264 or H.265 media, this system could do 4 streams of 4K media being converted into 1080p in Plex using hardware transcoding, which all works pretty well for me. Trying to get a 5th stream would struggle a bit, have long load times, not really work well. I also have this video here where I was just kind of scrubbing between some 4K to 1080p transcodes to see kind of what the response time is like. I compared it to a bit faster of a system I had, and it was roughly the same in terms of scrubbing performance with transcoding, but I'm also curious if you're watching this video and have Plex set up with transcoding, what those sorts of scrubbing times look like for you, because I don't have a huge amount of reference here. But overall, for transcoding wise, if you're working with media that this system supports hardware wise, which is most H.264 and H.265 variants, it played just fine. It's also capable of converting H.265 HDR footage to SDR in hardware and works quite well. I can't complain about this system transcoding wise, and it's likely more than enough for most users. And that's not including the multiple other streams you could have running at the same time using direct play. This is a pretty good processor for Plex, especially at its power consumption. Taking a look at thermals on the CPU, this small heatsink seemed to struggle a little bit. It ran fairly toasty in my sustained tests, somewhere in kind of the, depending on exactly how many drives you have and the exact thermals, somewhere in kind of the mid to high 80s to the 90s and sometimes in the low 100s degrees C range. This system would definitely run pretty toasty in here. The good news is the small compact fan on its default fan setting was nearly silent in every bit of testing I ran it on, and if I turned the fan up to max, even in its highest RPM of about 5400 RPM, it was still pretty quiet once I get roughly a meter away from the unit. And with the CPU fan running at max, I could sustain running the CPU at higher power limits for longer periods of time, and run the system at like 17 watts of power consumption with its fan running at max speed all the time. Although with temps nearing 100 degrees C, that is hotter than I'd like to see on a box like this. I do want to note that I accidentally took the system apart to film B-roll before doing thermal testing, so I replaced the thermal paste with Noctua thermal paste, and hopefully the numbers are fairly close, but I've made that decision for my thermal testing, so unfortunately that's the best numbers I have. I do also want to note with case temperatures, because of how it uses the case to help cool the CPU, the top of the case runs fairly warm when it's under sustained loads, but the bottom of the case runs quite hot. And I'm guessing this is likely coming from the M.2 drives, as without those M.2 drives, the case is fairly tame. But I did have some higher power M.2 drives, and when using the system for a longer period of time, the bottom metal case would become hot enough that I couldn't really hold it. So I think that is getting to my point of unacceptably hot, even for a system that probably shouldn't be touched and moved very often under load. Power consumption wise, this depends greatly on the SSDs you're using, as having 6 even low power SSDs can pull quite a bit of power over time. But in my initial test, this system ran in the mid to high single digits power consumption with no additional drives running idle in either Linux or Windows, lower kind of about 6 to 7 watts in Linux and 9 watts in Windows it looks like, and kind of in the teens wattage with a few drives in kind of light to medium NAS use. Under more heavy use when doing transcoding or maxing out the CPU, the system maxed out at about 27 watts, which compared to other units seems pretty acceptable and within the reasonable power consumption range, but it does also have the additional 2.5-inch drive bays, which was likely what's using that extra power on this unit, and I think it's hard to get much lower power consumption than a unit like this for the amount of drives they have in this system. Taking a look at the other components on the board, there is 16 gigabytes of RAM, which is the maximum this system can support, and nice to see actually a pretty decent amount of RAM included on the unit, although it is not upgradable. And there's also 128 gigabytes of, they list it as ROM, it's read-write memory, but it is eMMC storage. Here's a quick crystal disk mark number of this storage's performance in Windows. It's fine. It's fairly slow, but more than enough for a boot drive. Overall, internally, this is a pretty well-packed system and seems to be pretty densely packed inside this unit. Some of the little ribbon connectors are kind of a pain to work with, but there's not really a good reason for most users to get inside of this unit, as there's no really other replaceable or upgradable parts once you beyond the drive bays on this unit. Now let's take a look at software on this system. This system comes with unRAID, and it includes a license key for a full permanent version of the system and not just a trial license. And from everything I can tell, the system only comes with unRAID. There's no option for easily getting the system without an unRAID included license. And as far as NAS software goes, unRAID's pretty simple to use, lets you mix drives pretty well if you want to have kind of a mismatched or used M.2 drives you had laying around in this system, supports ZFS if you want those features, easy to use app and plugin features, and I'd say for most uses, I'm pretty happy with unRAID, has lots of good community support for it, and probably better than a lot of these smaller NAS manufacturers trying to build their own OS. So I think it's hard for me to complain with unRAID as an included OS option, and I think it was kind of interesting seeing them choose that as a choice, and I'm actually pretty glad that they went with it. Now, I, in my opinion, would like to see a version of the system without the unRAID license, because I think there's some use cases that would be better served with other OSs, and I'd like to save the money, but I see the mindset of trying to sell this as kind of a pre-setup box that you don't have to really think about the OS options, and you just get unRAID with it. As far as using other OSs, the system isn't locked down at all, and you can easily enter the BIOS and boot from whatever OS you want on the system. I put Windows 10 on it just fine, Windows 11 installed on the system just fine and met all the system requirements for that. You can install Debian or other Linux distros on the system as well, and it all works just fine. There's no OS lockdowns on this system. My kind of complaints with unRAID on this system, and this gets into kind of my thoughts about the hardware combination and how they picked all the specs as a whole, is the fact that there's multiple bits of hardware on this box that unRAID can't use or can't easily use and needs additional configuration. For example, it has a built-in audio out jack that unRAID won't use, has 128 gigabytes of what they call ROM, but is actually eMMC storage, that unRAID doesn't show up at all by default, as unRAID doesn't use the kernel module to use the eMMC store. The other thing unRAID can't use is the built-in Wi-Fi. You can pass that through to a VM, but it's not usable at all on this system. And seeing that this is a budget system that uses probably a decent amount of their budget for this unRAID license that comes with it, it seems odd that they're putting in multiple features that unRAID can't use by default. And just seems odd to me that they do that. It might make sense if they were planning on making like a Windows version or TrueNAS or some other OS that can use those features better, but from everything I can see, it's sold as a unRAID only box. So I'd either love a different cheaper model that rips out those features unRAID doesn't easily use, or show it to me with a different OS that has it, because I think that would take better advantage of the included hardware. Drive-wise, the drive bays are really nice on this system, and 4 M.2 bays gives you quite a few options in the total amount of storage you put in the system. I'm guessing they went with the additional 2.5-inch drive bays because the CPU has two onboard SATA ports as well as its PCIe lanes, and that's kind of the best way to use the I/O on the CPU. I am typically a fan of having all the same types of drive bays as it lets me have all identical drives on a unit, but it makes sense that if they just wanted to use all the ports on the CPU, they picked it that way, and I would happily take a 2.5-inch SATA port over a M.2 SATA port, because I can easily convert from a 2.5-inch SATA port to M.2, but I can't convert from M.2 SATA to 2.5. I would have loved to see this system be a little bit thicker, and I think that would have given me the option to put in 15 millimeter drives if I wanted to use those 5 or 6 terabyte 2.5-inch hard drives, While those aren't the best drives on the market, they might make sense for storing media or like something like a built-in backup drive. And it would also give them more room to put a slightly bigger cooler and fan in, which would help keep the CPU temperatures cooler, keep the exterior of the unit a bit cooler, and especially as the system has its thermal paste and dust make the temperatures worse over time, just help the CPU stay a little bit cooler and faster. Ports-wise, I think this unit was pretty well balanced. USB Type-C is nice if you want to have like a boot storage or some extra files you want to copy off of. And the HDMI and USB ports are nice for managing and first-time setup. And I'm guessing you're going to just use the 2.5 gigabit and power jack for the majority of the use of this system. When it comes to network speeds and internal I/O speeds, these low-power CPUs limit you a good amount, as I was talking about the 1 gigabit PCIe Gen 3 by 1 connection to all the SSDs. And 2.5 gig kind of makes sense. 5 gigabit probably would have been a nice upgrade you could have mostly taken full advantage of, but 10 gigabit probably wouldn't be used very well, especially with unRAID, which in a good amount of its operations only does I/O to one drive in its default array setup. And I'm guessing for a lot of the users of this system, 2.5 gig is probably gonna be enough. Now I wanna take a look at kind of more of these compact SSD-only NAS units as a whole, and just kind of see where they look in the lineup. A lot of people, kind of like me for my personal stuff, want to get the most bang for their buck, and you're going to be using hard drives for that use case for probably still a good amount more years now, and a system like this doesn't make sense. But many users want to have a compact system that's near silent without the hard drive seek sounds, uses less power, and isn't susceptible to shock if you want to use it on something like an RV or a bus or some other moving vehicle. And a system like this could make a good amount of sense for you. While the system is branded as having up to 48 terabytes of capacity, you're paying a lot per gigabyte if you want to get anywhere near that, so I'd say a more reasonable limit is maybe in something of the dozen, maybe two dozen terabytes before the price per gigabyte starts to go way up on a box like this. And compared to other NAS-focused mini PCs, it's relatively comparable, but if I pull up the NAS part and just look at the processor and I/O in the system, these NAS mini PCs definitely carry a premium. Maybe it's just because they don't sell a lot of units, but looking at like just the hardware to connect these M.2 bays doesn't seem like $200 worth of hardware to me, but it's kind of one of those, you don't really have an option unless you want to have a mini PC with a lot of external USB drives plugged into it. And I know many people who are happy to pay that premium for a system that has the included features, even though it technically doesn't add that much to the total BOM or bill of materials of the system they're buying. And I could definitely see a system filling a use case of people who want that small SSD NAS features, don't need the maximum performance, and the included processor is plenty for a lot of use cases. There are still some odd decisions the makers or pickers of the specs of this unit picked, like the eMMC storage and unRAID, which don't go together, built-in Wi-Fi, but as the unit does what it says it does, reasonably priced for the hardware that it has included on this unit, but there's not a ton of comparisons for a box like this right now. Let me know in the comments below, is this a type of box or a form factor you'd be interested in? Would you want more storage with your SSD-only NAS units? Are you going to stick with hard drives as long as you can until the price gets cheaper for SSDs? I'm curious what you guys feel like for NAS units like this, so let me know in the comments below, and thanks for watching.